The signal is received. Our antennas were broken. His powerful voice was silent. His love remained a rumor. Still, it was there. Endless, but invisible. Until at that moment of belief, the Spirit tuned us in. And suddenly, the truest things exploded into view. Pictures of God's goodness, the music of His grace, received with joy in the highest definition. We gather now to worship the one who sends the signal and thank Him for the eyes to see the beauty of His love.
What a joy it is to gather together in the name of the Lord. Let's rise up together and sing our opening hymn, softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. On the portals, He's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home, ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling. Oh, sinner, come home. Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me? Why should we linger and heed not His mercies, mercies for you and for me? Passing from you and from me. Shadows are gathering, deathbeds are coming, coming for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Oh, for the wonderful love. Mercy and pardon, pardon for you.
you not know? Have you not heard?
Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth.
He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall.
But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength.
They will soar on wings like eagles.
They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
Voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. You say I am love when I can't feel a thing. You say I am strong when I think I am weak. You say I am hell when I am falling short.
What a blessing it is, Lord, that when you created all things, you rested and then instructed your chosen people to take a day of Sabbath. We have come into your presence on the Sabbath day, a time set apart from the rest of our week to worship you, to rest in your presence, to be recharged for the week to come. It is with awe and reverence that we gather in your Son's name. opening ourselves to the conviction, healing, comfort, instruction, and power of your Holy Spirit. This is why we come before you and proclaim your indescribable love, mercy, and grace. Let us join together as you are the center of everything. Join us in singing, Be the Center.
Jesus, be the center. Be my source, be my life, Jesus.
I invite you to have a seat as we move into a moment of silent meditation to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us as we continue to prepare ourselves in worship. Amen. Welcome to Cheatham Memorial Methodist Church. It is a blessing to be here with all of you today to worship the Lord, to proclaim his name, and to listen to the Holy Spirit as he speaks to us and through us, that we might go back into the world and share the good news with all that we meet. In the pew, there is a red book. If you wouldn't mind letting us know that you're worshiping with us, it's usually in the middle of the pew. If you'd fill that out and let us know that you're here today. If you're new with us, please make sure you leave a phone number and address or an email so we can connect with you. And that way we can send you a letter or give you a call in the days ahead. My name is Reverend David McLaughlin, for those who don't know me. And it's a blessing to be the pastor here at this church. If you're online, if you'd also like to leave us a like, follow us, and let us know that you're worshiping with us, that would be wonderful as well. With that, I'm going to invite Miss Sabrina Eskew to come forward. And if we have any children that would like to come up, I know that she has a message for you this morning. All right, you got one running. Can't get here fast enough.
All right. He's afraid I'm going to get a spot. So, Pastor David, is your sermon on rest? Rest, okay. Well, there's a lot of restful songs going on this morning, so I thought maybe I'd hit the nail on the head. Yes, we all need rest. Okay, so this morning, we are going to talk about poo. Not Winnie the Pooh. No, no, no. So me and Lucas and his best friend went camping this week, and I got up and I put the tent in the truck and I loaded the cooler and all the stuff that was fishing stuff. Oh my word, the fishing stuff that we had to take. And I packed it all in the car, and then I took it all to the campsite, and I unpacked it all, and I pitched the tent, it started a fire, and then the boys decided they wanted to go kayaking. And I was like, okay. So knowing animals and woodland creatures, you probably shouldn't leave your campsite unattended, but I did. The boys went camping, or they went kayaking. And I watched them, and when we came back, I noticed the tent was unzipped. And I was like, oh no. So I go and I look inside, and a little curious bird had been in my tent. And out of all of God's creation, he chose on top of my bed to go poo. And let me tell you, I was tired. I needed rest. So I had to go get a Lysol wipe, wipe my air mattress off, threw a blanket down on top of it, and I laid down and I went to sleep. But you know what was really great is that while I was sleeping, we left the rain fly off the tent so we could see the stars. And I laid there and I just cuddled up under my blanket and I just felt God's love, and I rested like a baby. And the scripture that I wanted to share to you was, come to me, all that are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. So when you feel overwhelmed and you've just worked so hard and you've done all this stuff, sometimes we just need to run to God, and he will give us rest. Okay? So can y'all pray with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for your supernatural rest.
Thank you for your supernatural rest.
Lord, help me to run to you.
Lord, help me to run to you.
I ask it in your holy name, amen. Okay.
I'm going to invite the children to head on off. Just make sure you don't leave your tent unzipped where birds are and get that rest. I'm going to invite the rest of you to rise up, greet one another, and welcome each other into church this morning. invite us to move into a time of silent prayer. You may have a seat. Oh, I'm sorry. Before that, stay rest. I forgot. This is the third Sunday, and we need to do the Apostles' Creed and speak the words that we truly believe. Let's join together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father.
You may be seated. Let's join together in a moment of prayer as we remember that we are not sufficient, that we do things that wound the body of Christ, that wound one another and break our relationship with God. So let's take a moment for silent confession as the piano continues to play. Lord, we thank you that while we are not sufficient, that we cannot do things on our own. Lord, that we may have gifts and talents and skills, and you may speak to us through your Holy Spirit, trying to guide us each and every day and in every moment. But Lord, we mess up. We don't listen to the call that you've put upon us. We hurt those around us, and we don't love you with our whole heart, mind, soul, and strength. We thank you that you sent your Son Jesus, who fulfilled the law and overcame it and offers us grace. And that if we confess with our lips and desire to change and turn towards you and repent from our sins, Lord, that we can be forgiven. So it's through Christ Jesus that we find our forgiveness. Amen. But we just don't offer up our confessions each week. We come together to also offer our praise and thanksgiving to God. We're supposed to honor him and give him glory for all the goodness of this life. Does anyone have anything or a person in your life that has blessed you this week? I invite you to lift up their name or that situation. For family. For Peggy Stevens. Lord, for the rain that comes and brings new life in this season of preparation for crops that will grow, Lord, we give you thanks. For those that gather and work on this property, for those who serve in this community, for those who sing and praise you, Lord, we give you thanks for all these things and so much more. Just for the first breath we took this morning, Lord, for this one we take right now, and the one to which we will fall into slumber tonight, Lord, we give you thanks, knowing that you are the author of life, the giver of life, who breathed life into us. And Lord, it is so good to be here today, to be able to breathe and sing and speak and to share life with other people, in Jesus' name. Lord, we know there are those who are hurting today, struggling with life, struggling with health, loss of a loved one. So, Lord, we now lift their names before you. For Donnie's family. Lord, for all of those people in places of war right now, people who've been affected by disasters across the globe, for the volcanoes that have erupted, Lord, we lift up all of those in harm's path this day. For all of those who have lost lives in the Middle East with the conflict in Israel, and Lord, we just lift up them up to you. And for our own community, Lord, in all that's going on here, we lift people who are struggling this day financially, Lord, in spirit. We lift them all into your care. Especially we lift those who have lost loved ones who are in that season of mourning, that the Holy Spirit might come and comfort and guide them, and that we as your body might go back into the world and share the love that you have given to us with everyone that we meet. And we thank you, Lord, that while your Son was amongst us, he gave us a prayer that we might share in common with all Christians across the globe, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'm going to invite our ushers to receive our gifts, tithes, and offerings. And while they do, I have a couple of announcements that we need to bring forth before the body. So, family photos, if you have not, or individual photos, if you have not taken your photo yet for the new directory, please see Ina after worship in the fellowship hall, and then next week I'll be taking them before worship and then after worship as well. If you like your photo that you took about 5 years ago, we'll put that one in the directory as well, but we're coming up with a new directory, and we'd love to have your faces in that directory. Palm Sunday next Sunday is our children's program. I'm so looking forward to seeing the children lead us in worship on Palm Sunday. And then there is a community Easter service here this year right afterwards at 6 p.m. that evening. We hope you join us for that. Pastor Chuck over at New Journey is going to be preaching that night, and it's going to be a wonderful service. Then Holy Week services, we have Holy Thursday at 6 p.m., Good Friday, 6 p.m., Easter eggs and Easter services. I hope you'll join us for that on Easter Sunday on the 31st. Please bring any donated candy to help with our Easter egg hunt. You can drop it off this week at the office so that we can get it all taken care of for the Easter egg hunt. Board meeting is tomorrow. Everyone is welcome to our board meetings, but to vote, you'll have to be a member of the board. We have some things we need to deal with. We meet about 6 times a year, and so we hope to be doing all the work on your behalf. We've had lots of plumbing and other issues we've had to deal with, and so it's good that we have done that work. Our men's fellowship is kicking off next Saturday. For the first time in a while, since COVID, we're having a men's breakfast. We hope that you'll join us here 8:30 in the morning. We're going to talk about mission and what we're going to be doing as a men's fellowship together. So please join us for that if you'd like to do that. Easter lilies. We have found that there has been that our normal vendor is unable to get Easter lilies this year. So we will have a few that will be up here, and if you would like to take one and donate for that, that would be great, but we're not doing the normal donations. Our normal supplier said that they're not doing Easter lilies because they're not readily available this year through the normal sources. So please let Karen know, and we'll have those available up here. Any other announcements are in your bulletin. Please make sure that you read that, and let's rise up and once more and sing praise to God from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
We do praise you, Father, for all the many ways in which we are blessed. We thank you for the times that we have been able to work and labor in the fields and do the work that you've called us to do. We now give back a portion of that to you, that which you have given us already. May these gifts be used for your good purposes here in Edgewood, at Cheatham, and beyond. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. My name is Carol Williams. Please remain standing in body or in spirit for the reading of God's word. Now hear these words from Philippians 4:4-9 and James 4:4-6. From Philippians, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. From James, you adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think the scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the spirit he has caused to dwell in us? But he gives us more grace. That is why scripture says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. This is the word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God.
You may be seated. Did you ever say, or did your parents ever say to you these words? Don't sit too close to the TV or you're going to go blind. Did you ever hear that before? I remember hearing that all the time back in the 70s and 80s. Well, I got to tell you, apparently there's no truth to that claim, as people today spend more time looking at screens today than you could have ever have looked at back in the 70s. In fact, we now are, 12 inches away from a screen versus a TV when you were 24 or 36 inches away and you were looking and someone said to you, don't sit too close to the screen or someday you're going to go blind. You know, today we are going to be talking about the habit of screen time. In the 1950s, and only 9% of all households had a TV. But by the 1960s, nearly 90% of all households in the U.S. had a TV in just 10 years. Prior to the 1970s, most Americans' households had one black and white TV. There were three major networks, and many markets had some smaller local channels, or you could like get the antenna to the UHF if you remember those days. 50 years later, the average household now has 17 connected devices to the internet and at least 10 major screens that require your attention, not including all the little minor things like TV remotes, appliances, and the car dashboard. In the early 1970s, the average American spent 2.5 hours watching TV, or 75 hours a month. Today, the average American looks at a screen 7-plus hours a day between TVs, tablets, smart computers, phones, and other smart devices, or about 210 hours a month. And when looking at millennials and Gen Z, that number rises to 9 hours a day, or 270 hours a month. Now, if the average American gets 7 hours of sleep, and some of you are going to laugh, and then you remove those 7 from 24, there are a total of 510 waking hours per month. For the general population today, 41% of our time is looking at a screen, and for the younger generation, 53% of all waking hours are connected somehow to a screen of some kind. Well, if you were to take the biblical account of time from Abraham's birth in around 2160-something B.C. to today, where 90% of Americans had one TV in the 1960s, that would represent roughly 4,125 years. And then from 1960s until today, that's about 60 years. So in the annuals of time from Abraham until the TV was first in houses, that represent 99.99% of history, where there were no screens available to anyone. In less than 0.004% of the time of all of history, we've gone from 2 hours a week looking at a screen to more than 50% of our time looking at a screen. I'd like for you to take a quick moment of silence to go through your own house and make a mental note of all of the screens in your life. I've given you a list up there if you want to go to the next slide of all the things you might consider your TV, your computer, your tablet, your cell phone, your laptop, your watch, your Fitbit, the car dashboard, alarm clocks, digital radios, printers, CD players, refrigerators, washers and dryers, HVAC control, sprinkler control, thermometer, meat thermometer, children's toys, blood pressure monitor, TV remote. And you think of any other screens that you look at some point during the day. I'm going to give you about 15, 20, maybe 30 seconds to make a mental note. Walk through your house in every room and think about all the screens that you look at every day. Go. Anyone have a number? Anyone? One I didn't even have up there. Great. Anyone have a number that are in your house? What's that? 8? You think 8 total? Anyone else? I actually went through our house. Go ahead, anyone? 11. I went through our house and we have 33. When you consider the thermometer for my meat has a screen, the little tiny remote that for the TV has a screen, my AC conversion has a screen, my little tiny unit that's in the shed that I use that's just the screen there has a screen. There are 33 screens in our life every single week, from the laptops to the TVs to the thermal ear thermometer and the barbecue meat thermometer. I want to challenge you to go home and look around and open all your drawers and count the number of screens in your household this week. And I'd love to hear from you on that. But for now, would you please pray with me? Holy Spirit, clear our minds and open our hearts. Touch our spirits and draw us to you now with your word. And as the word is proclaimed today, forgive the sins of the one who speaks, for there are many. But allow the words spoken today reflect the life of Jesus, only Jesus. Amen. Now, screens in and of themselves are not a bad thing. And as everything that's in this life, God can use all things for good. But as I was reflecting on the subject, I began to think about the time and the particularity about the time and how much time is given to our screens. There are some great things that happen on screens. I've talked about this before, but if you notice Thursday morning, there was something that happened that's never happened before. I got to watch a live feed on my phone of the third test flight of the SpaceX giant spaceship that took off from Bolsa Chica, first on my cell phone at home, and then in the car it sat on the seat, and then when I got to the church, I turned it on to my laptop and kept the live feed. I mean, live feed of this rocket that is 400 feet tall, 50 feet shorter than the tallest pyramid in Giza, and 50 feet taller than the Statue of Liberty, that took off into the sky. Not only did they have great ground footage, but the rocket produced live feeds through their Starlink thing up in the space that included an inside look of the rocket when the doors opened up to the outside for the future and they closed. And then on re-entry, we got to see live image of the glowing of the wings as the plasma was building up on the outside of the wings before it blew up and fell into the sea. Amazing things that can happen when you look at your phone. I mean, I can check my pulse on my phone, right? On my watch here, because it has a screen, right? Just like your Fitbit might. I get to my computer and I look at how my glucose levels are going because I wear a patch thing on my arm, and then it goes to my phone and then over to my computer, and I can watch that. I can do FaceTime or video chat with family and friends and strangers across the globe. I mean, what a great thing that we can do with screens. Specialized doctors can operate from halfway around the world via a screen and robotic arms. Amazing things that can happen. Those at home today or watching during the week can log in and watch our worship service and to be connected. I mean, great uses for screens. Once again, screens in and of themselves are not a bad thing and can be used for wonderful ways. But then there are all the ways that this technology that God gave us creatively to be used have been used to control and deceive and to destroy lives. Without getting into all the horrific things, I could spend all day just talking about the horrific things that happen on screens, if we let them. But what I'd like to focus on for the few moments that we have is to look at our habitual use of them and how they have become the norm for us. And that as Christians, maybe we need to do some reflection on the amount of time that we spend on screens. The first issue with having so many screens in our lives is the attention that we give them. It's not about what's on them, but just the attention that we give them. In his book, The Habits of the Household, Justin Early talks, this young 40-year-old author and lawyer talks about the first thing he does in the morning. What's the first thing he does in the morning? He says, first thing I do is I roll over and I grab my phone and begin scanning all my work emails. and I wake to the monster of performance. How have I performed? The story of reality about what I can get accomplished today and whether I can justify my existence begins at that first glance in the morning. When I begin the morning in social media, I wake to the monsters of comparison and envy. The story of reality is about a picture of other people's lives and whether I can measure up. When I begin in the morning on the news headlines, the monsters of fear and anger nearly jump through the screen at me. And the story of reality is how the world is falling apart and how mad I should get at others who just don't get it, because I do. As I read this paragraph of this book about the habits of waking up, what I'm finding is that he's described me, right? Now, you don't have to raise your hands, but if you were to think back over the last month, how many of you experienced some kind of screen as your first and last experience of your day? Before bed, you check the news, you check your email, you check social media, you verify that your morning alarm is set, and then you make sure your phone is plugged in to make sure that you can wake up in the morning. Or maybe you set the TV to a sleep timer and you see a screen. Now, I'm not just talking cell phones, but you set your timer to go off in 30 minutes and that's your habit. Or maybe you just decide to leave it on all night because you need a companion with you on a screen to keep you safe during the night. How many of you wake up from your bed to a cell phone because it's your alarm and you pick it up to turn it off, and before or after rubbing your eyes, you see you have 10 emails, the 3 breaking news alerts, and who knows how many social media posts that require your attention. Not only does this happen first thing in the morning, but throughout the day, right as we're connected and non-connected, smart and dumb screens alike are constantly trying to get your attention to look at them. Now, some of it's for good reason, but most of it is because someone else's voice is trying to get a message into your head. Every morning when I get dressed, I check my screen to see what the weather's going to be right for the day. You hear, right, I've learned you don't know what the weather's going to be hour to hour, so you need to look at the hourly thing. And as you click on the screen to find the weather, what happens? You get a ton of ads that tell you this is what you should buy, this is what you should think, unless you want to pay a fee every single month. Now, it's amazing that we can get a weather update anywhere in the world in a fraction of a second. But there's a voice trying to get into my head every time I go to the weather now. And unless I want to pay a $2.99 subscription, in which now they've got my pocket and got my attention through my pocket, I have to endure endless advertisements of products being tried to sold to me. And even if it's just a glance before I click the X to click out the ad, it still made an impression on my brain that required my attention to click the X. If I want to watch a TV program that looks interesting, that allows someone else's voice is speaking to me and into my head because they have a position that they're speaking from. When I read the news, there's always a slant to a story, or watch it on TV. There's bias in there. We all know that, right? How many of you have actually seen an unbiased news report lately? Someone's got a position and they're trying to prove a point. And it gets me angry because they must be wrong, or yeah, I agree with them, and so I have to keep watching them. And if I don't like the direction the article is going, I can simply use the click back to find another article or author that agrees with my own bias, all on a screen. When I go to purchase something online, right, I see all the options in one place, and I can go and read the product reviews and see if this is the exact thing I need. But then in a second, without even thinking about it, I can make an instant purchase, an irrevocable purchase that will arrive the next day. All of this from a screen where there's no instantaneous gratification pause filter. Right, what do I mean by there's no instantaneous gratification pause filter? Right, in past generations, if you wanted to make a purchase, what did you have to do? You had to think about what it was that you wanted to purchase. You might do some research, and then you had to figure out which store you were going to go to, and then you actually had to drive to the store, maybe pick it up with your hands and read the box, or there was a demo that you might try, and waiting in and the travel time, and getting to that moment may overcome that immediate instant gratification of just saying, I need this, I need that. No, look, this is a better product over here. Oh, and they're selling me this too. I need that too because I bought this. Have you ever seen that at the bottom of an Amazon? These people also purchase these products. They've gotten in your head to say, this is what you also need instant gratification because someone's in your head from what you've seen on the screen. When one of my friends on Facebook posts a meme about a politician, an issue, an enemy, a friend, and an institution, that's actually now third and fourth party voices that are speaking in my head, right? I see the meme that they may have posted, and that person had a reaction to what the original author or someone did or said. And then I have some preconceived ideas about the person who's posted the meme, and so now I'm into second person. And then I read their comments, and now that's third person commentary on the second person meme. And then what I do, I look down to see what all the other people are saying about what that person said about the meme that someone else created. Now I'm third and fourth party in my head on social media. And they've got my attention, and they're taking my time. But then there are those comments, right? The fourth party voices that put a conversation in my head. Even more insidious way to get other people's voices into your head in screens is through just social media, right? In November 2021, a landmark article written by researcher Jonathan Haidt exposed what he called the dangerous experiment of teen girls. Haidt specifically was writing about the effects of social media on girls and young women. As he wrote, much more than boys, adolescents typically heightened girls' self-consciousness about their changing body and amplifies insecurities about where they fit in their social network. Social media takes the worst parts of middle school and glossy women's magazines and intensifies them, especially for women. Haidt revealed that the rates of depression and anxiety among teenagers have risen sharply in the past decade, and with that rise beginning around the year 2011. Those rates mirrored similar rises in suicide and self-harm, and they seem to be especially prominent among girls. The timing point to social media, Haidt concluded. Incredibly, Haidt also pointed to the research that showed that young girls were even aware of the harm that social media platforms were causing in their lives, yet they felt worse about themselves the more that they used the platforms. Yet they continued to use screens for social media platforms because their self-image, as good or as bad as they seemed, is based on what is being fed to them through a screen. See, it's not just the screen's claim of our attention. They're actually in a fight for our fundamental formation and character and values. Justin explains this best. He says, screens are an incredibly formative because they convey stories and images that captivate our imaginations. This doesn't make them bad, it just gives them power, and the power can be used for good or for evil. But the fact is, for both us parents and our children, we will either form our screen habits or our screen habits will form us. There's no alternative. If we're averaging 7 hours a day on a screen or giving 40 to 50% of our life to a screen, this is the fight for who forms who. Our TV advertising and programming and social media as recruiting tools has been successful to influence generations around different issues. Of course, most glaringly right now is the example of the LGBTQ community. In the most recent report of numbers by the U.S. Census data, or Statistica, homosexuality among the silent generation, baby boomers, and Gen X is less than 3%, and it stayed there. But in the late 1990s, there was a huge campaign in TVs and movie programmings, the news, and on social media normalizing the LGBT community, and now 11.2% of millennials and nearly 20% of Gen Zs identify in the LGBTQ community. Women are nearly twice as likely as men to claim that status versus men. And if you look at the study done in 2021, it has to do with self-esteem. Someone else's voice is in our head telling us what is normalized and what is not. Now, I'm not just picking on that one issue, because I could have picked violence or any other issue, but I just saw the statistics on that. And you can see the clear influence of what screens have done and the amount of time we spend on screens around our own identity as human beings. To have a 567% change in two generations on any issue must be attributed to something in our culture. And one of the major shifts has been the voices influencing us on screens. Now, that's not the only factor, but what we do know is that low self-esteem can leave young people extremely vulnerable to outside recruiting voices, to different positions, and to violence and other things. Consider what is at stake here with regards to screen time. If we don't guard our own screen time and the screen time of those that we love and care about, children, grandchildren, screens will be happy to do it for us. The screens will tell you exactly what you should believe and who you should follow. The screens we look at are more than happy to teach us about good and evil, values and purpose, our orientation, and more than willing to shame us into submission to someone else's vision of the world if we're not careful. It's incumbent upon us to either form our own screen habits or else our screen habits will form us. And that brings me to the scriptures for this morning. 2 weeks ago, we used Romans 12 to talk about how we should not be conformed to the world, but that we should be transformed by the renewing of our minds. I can't see anywhere that may be more important around the issue of our screen time and not conforming to the world, but being transformed. But that leads me to the letter of Jesus' brother James, penned to the early church, and his words were probably more important to us today if you read them around our issues here around screen times. He says to them, he says, "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity with God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to become a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God." Now, the adulterous reference here is not necessarily about the act between two human beings. No, it's the seductive nature of the world calling us to worship anything other than the God of creation. It's anything that becomes a normalized habit that does not honor your relationship with those who you've made covenant with and with God. And so much of our screens today call us away from that relationship with God towards the love of something else. I don't need to name them all because each of us could come up with a long list of the things that draw us away from God. But in almost every one of those things, you may find a screen which has become the vehicle by which we fall in love. How many of you remember the lifestyles of the rich and famous? And I'm not going to ask you to say if you ever watched that show. It was a huge show. Have you ever watched Survivor? Have you ever watched any of the news about the different trials and the inquiries about our politicians recently? All about an adulterous generation who are following other values than the ones God has called us to. James continues in verse 5. He says, "Or do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he has caused to dwell in us?" See, our screens can lure our hearts, our minds, and our time away from the jealousy that God desires to show us when he has the Spirit dwell in us. Right, we come to baptism, a profession of faith, and we make a profession that we're going to follow him, and then all of a sudden, screens call us to other places. And if we're giving away nearly half of our time to screens, how much time does that leave for the Spirit who's trying to dwell in us and speak to us when there's all these other voices speaking to us? Remember, unless you're a creator of content, your screen time is almost always someone else trying to plant a seed in your mind. Which leads me to the resolution that Justin comes to in and around habits of screen time, and that is a one word, curation. What does it mean to be a curator of something? It's to make a decision around that thing. We know that it's nearly impossible to get away from all screen time, but if we create a plan to take control of our screen time, then it won't control us. What if we took time to reorient our habits around others' control of our screen time and calling us and access to our mind and developed a plan to make sure that screens weren't taking over? As I mentioned, for 24 years, I've taken trips with youth to mission projects. What I discovered is that after cell phones became popular among teens, how much teens were distracted by their cell phones when they were on the mission projects. So the group said there's no more screens allowed, no more cell phones allowed. All the cell phones were to be left at home or confiscated during the week and put in a locked place. At first, what do you think happened with all the teens? "I can't live without my cell phone. I can't do without a screen." But I got to tell you, as the week went on, what they discovered was a freedom from the screen that many have never experienced in the last 50 years. The anxiety of having to look went away when they were face to face with other youth without access to any screen. And to be honest, I never saw a group of happier youth more engaged with one another, less anxious when they didn't have a screen for a week. What would you do if you didn't have any screens for a week? And that leads me to Philippians 4, where the Apostle Paul said that we should rejoice in the Lord always. I say again, what? Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything. Let me pause here again, because what I've come to realize is that much of what's on screens today is anxiety building, and rarely is there anything gentle or rejoicing in the Lord on screens. You need to limit our time of worry by simply curating the amount of time and energy that we're willing to allow others to put anxiety on us through the screens that we look at. Remember, either we will form our screen time habits, or our habits will form us. He continues on, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. I just love that line in the text. In every situation, present your request to God. I wonder if there is any correlation between the amount of screen time that we now spend in America and the loss of faith as a nation. The more screen time we have, the less time we have to give thanks, especially when people are putting their anxieties on us and presenting our request to God. As the screen shows us what everyone else is requesting of us rather than what we should be requesting of God. Money and power and wealth and fame, likes and thumbs up, personal gratification, objectification of people and things are what happens on screens. And how can we be in a constant relationship with God through the Holy Spirit when we are on the phone talking with someone while playing the latest whatever game, wasting time while the news is on? Anyone ever notice that you're on three screens at once? There's no way that the next line can happen. See, and then the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Can't do that when you're on three screens. But this is the blessing we receive when we're able to respond to the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is trying to teach us and correct us and comfort us and call us towards. And most of the time, the screens are distracting us. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, read that with me. Think about such things. And while some of that on a screen might be these things, like maybe your Bible app on your phone or using social media to help someone or pray with someone, much of what are screens is not excellent, praiseworthy, or admirable. Much in our culture on screens is dishonorable, violent, demeaning, impure, ignoble, false, base, and not worth praise. Once again, curating your time away from the things of the culture and towards God is what I think was in Romans. But Paul closes out the teaching part of his letter to the church of Philippi with this challenge. He says, whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Don't conform to the ways of the world by giving your time, energy, and values and mind to what someone on a screen is trying to instill in us. No, put into practice what you've learned from Scripture and what you've learned from your family and the fellowship so that the peace of God might be with you all times. Let the one who formed you and breathed life into you and wants the very best for you to have your time, not a screen. Curate your screen time. So you might set aside some time for a movie rather than just flipping through the TV until you find something mildly interesting that catches your eye. Plan time for a game, but set an alarm at the end of it so that you don't waste the whole day away. Do what I'm going to be doing, purchasing an alarm clock to put next to your bed so that your cell phone is in the kitchen or in the bathroom so it's not the first thing you touch when you wake in the morning or when you lie down in the evening. Turn off the announcements on your phone so that you aren't distracted. And when you are ready, go and check them all. When you begin to curate your screen time, you put into practice, as Paul says, new habits that over time will become a new normal for you. I'm going to go back to the first words I spoke this morning, because I believe they are actually more relevant spiritually than physically. Don't sit too close to the TV. You might go blind. You might not go physically blind, but too much uncurated screen time can cause you to become spiritually blind. Here's the good news. When you mess up and fall back into your old habits around screen time, you begin to develop bad habits around your screen, and remember the words that James closes his section of his letter with. But he gives us more grace. Say that with me. Say it like you mean it. Part of developing a new habit is that you're going to fail along the way. Here's the blessing, though. God knows that we will fail, and that's why he offers us grace through his son, Jesus Christ. As you consider new habits around your screen time, I invite you to lean heavily into his grace. For it is through his grace that you discover the peace that passes all understanding. Lean into his grace, and you'll find that his grace is powerful and untamed and uncontainable and incomparable. Would you please rise up with the praise team and sing about the true God of creation, who is an amazing God, whose grace and love are indescribable.
From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing. All-powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing God. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? Or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow? Who imagines the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night? None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you love them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart, but you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God.
Okay, folks, confession time. That sermon was for me. Maybe it's for you too. Think about your screen time, and don't allow your screen time to keep you from the light that's truly the blessing in your life. Let's go forth by blessing one another to bless others, and maybe put away the cell phone, turn off the TV, and spend some time in real conversation. Get rid of the seventh hour. Maybe make it six to begin with. Let's bless each other. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Indescribable, uncontainable, you see the stars in the sky and you love him by name. You are amazing, God. Oh, powerful, unattainable.
Good morning. How are you today?
You see.